Well, the question was, is it possible to combine the tunnel made for cars and vehicles with the railway? There was one more.
How do you respond to the environmental, all the critique that we have heard yesterday? I mean, how do you take responsibility for the environment?
Okay, but
how do you?
Yeah, a general environmental question about the bypass.
Yeah.
I wasn't here yesterday, unfortunately, so I couldn't hear the criticism, but I can understand. I believe what it is. Okay, and the last one.
What were the alternatives you were looking into for the bypass? Like both like technical alternatives, where and how?
Yes.
How big should we do it at all?
Yes, good. The last question was, what are the alternatives and is it necessary to do it? Let's have the film.
Förbifarten behövs för knyta. Förbifarten behövs för att knyta samman söder och norr i vår region. Att vår region ska hänga samman och inte vara kluven.
Förbifart Stockholm behövs definitivt för att få en fungerande trafiklösning i Stockholm.
Det som är vår stora tillgång på många sätt, nämligen vattnet, är ju en barriär när det gäller resandet. Vi har inte tillräckligt många övergångar när det gäller vattnet, varken för bilar eller för kollektivtrafik. Det skapar ju proppar i vårt trafiksystem. Och det kostar ju för den enskilda människan tid och det kostar för hela samhället väldigt mycket pengar.
Viktig nytta med Förbifart Stockholm det är att knyta samman Stockholm till en gemensam bostad och arbetsmarknad. Så man inte får en uppdelning på en nordlig och en sydlig del utan får väl fungerande förbindelser däremellan. En annan viktig del är förstås att kunna avlasta Essingeleden där vi då har en väldigt kraftig trängsel och där små incidenter skapar stora problem.
Because the route is largely through tunnels, it will have limited impact on the surrounding environment. Connections to the existing road network are through 6 traffic exchanges. This will create a smooth north-south connection, avoiding all of Stockholm's bottlenecks.
I arbetet med planeringen utav Förbifart Stockholm så har vi arbetat mycket med att anpassa sträckningen till den lokala miljön som vi passerar. Och det har inneburit att merparten av den här sträckningen, där går vi i tunnel.
Well, the main reason for increasing the infrastructure within this region and to have the bypass built is the increasing population here in Stockholm. Historically, we had an increase here with roughly 20,000 people per year. The last year, it has been up to 40,000 a year. And if this will stay that way, we don't know. But at least these figures, they are from the 20,000 people a year. This region is very special as well. It's built on water. And it is divided through water here between the northern part and a southern part. And there are main big differences between these two parts. The northern parts, there you have the main airport, for example, Arlanda. You have more businesses in the northern parts. You have much more housing areas in the southern parts, which means that you have to be able to transport yourself between these two areas. And the region needs both public transport and road transport, possibilities to transport in every means. Here you can see the main way of transporting by road. It's called Essingeleden. It was built in the mid-60s, designed for 80,000 vehicles per day, today used by 180,000 vehicles per day. Here, in the very end, you can see Riddarholmen. And here you have the main connection point for the public transport. You have the subway, and you also have the railway. The railway was built in 1871 with two tracks, still the same, now being rebuilt with Citybanan, so you increase the capacity to more than the double of the capacity, because you separate the different trains from each other. So this is a very special situation that we have here in Stockholm. We have a very sensitive system. It's very vulnerable. And it's minor accidents, or minor incidents, causes major problems on the transport system. And it's both for the public transport and also for the road transport. It's the same situation for the whole system. A lot of investigations is going on, both for the public transport and one of the major ones for the road transport is the bypass of Stockholm. There's the regional plan, where one of the strategies is to point out regional areas for growth areas, both in the north and in the south, and of course the central part of Stockholm as well. And to connect these areas of development, you need both the Citybanan, as it's shown here, and also the bypass of Stockholm, because it is essential for these areas to grow and for the whole region to develop, to have a good infrastructure so that you can move between them. Well, the reduction of vulnerabilities is one of the points. Also, environmental benefits for the central parts of the city, because you take the traffic that today goes through the central part, goes out to the bypass, and reduces the traffic congestions within the city. Historically, it's been a long way. The left picture here, Kungshattsleden, started off in the 1960s. And as you can see, it was an on-surface road. And during the planning procedure from the 1960s and onward until today, it's been more and more tunneling. And this is something that goes on all over the world, because we are increasing, we have to develop the transport situation within the city areas, and more of the infrastructure goes underneath the surface. Well, the planning process started off for the bypass in 2001 with a feasibility study. And then with a feasibility study you look at many, several aspects, different aspects, and then you go down into a specific suggested solution. And we have, as part of the answer, one of the questions, we have looked into several different solutions, and by the end of the process, where we had looking at the preliminary design, there were three different solutions. One was a solution totally with public transport, the other ones were two road solutions, and the evaluation of these came out with the bypass as being the one that best suited the region. Today we are dealing with the final design plan. It will be decided on in the beginning of next year. We have started the construction documents and are due to start the construction, the main construction, next year. Preparing works are going on from this autumn. Parallel with this planning session here, we also do the municipalities' detailed plans, very important that they match. All the environmental aspects has to be dealt with, that is digging in the groundwater. The tunnel makes, of course, that you are dealing with the groundwater and also the surface water. And there you have certain, you have to have an application done, and you have to have certain rules for how you work and dig within the water area. Then you have Nature 2000, nature and culture reserves as well. One point here is, notice that it takes quite a long time, this planning time. We started off in 2001 and it's now 2012. And usually for large projects it takes that time. And actually it started off in the 1960s with the first idea. And I think that's due to the fact that it involves a lot of money, it involves a lot of political decisions, and also a lot of work with the public rehearsals, which is a very important part of the whole process. Well, what is the bypass? It's a highway or a motorway between the southern parts and the northern parts, between Kungens Kurva and Häggvik up here. Main part is in tunnels. It connects to certain points, and it's of course very expensive, 28 billion crowns approximately in the 2009 prices. I can also say that the production time, building time, will be approximately 10 years. So it's also a long time, and it's a big logistical problem, because you have a lot of material that you have to transport to and from. I mentioned the traffic before, and what happens here is that today we have Essingeleden, we also have major passages through the city. Essingeleden, the traffic will be reduced here significantly, and traffic will come out to the bypass. And the traffic within the bypass, it is traffic from the southern parts here to the northern parts mainly. Very little bypass traffic coming from the, like, Södertälje to Gävle or something like that. That's a very little portion of the main traffic here. And the traffic also within the center parts would have a reduction. When the bypass will open, you will have tolls on the Essingeleden, which is not there today. Also, public transport is an essential part of it, and we have been working together with the authorities dealing with the public transport here in the region, and it's public transport with bus. We have looked into the possibility of having railways as well, as one of the questions was, and it's not suitable for a railway in this connection here, because it's too far away from the built areas. And also, it's technically not suitable to combine road traffic and public transport with railway. I know it's done in some other places in the world, but we have looked into it, and with the systems that we have, it doesn't combine very well due to safety aspects and technical aspects of how the road is being. The curves of the road, for example, doesn't suit with the railways. Safety aspects. If you put the infrastructure in a tunnel, you will reduce the effects on the surface, but you will move down the problems into the tunnel. And traveling in the tunnel, you have to have a good and healthy environment, and also a safe environment. So we have been working a lot with these aspects over the traveling. And as you can see here, we have many different systems for helping the drivers to come to have a safe and a good journey. This is a part of the design as a sign criteria or design within the tunnel. I have a film here. We have made a model within Linköping where you can drive through the tunnel. I won't show you the whole film because it's 15 minutes. But as you can see here, you can drive through the tunnel, and doing this, you're sitting in a car. It's just like driving on any highway, and you have cars passing you, you can overtake cars, you can steer within this tunnel. And we have been evaluating how people think, how the driver, what he needs to have a safe drive, how much information does he need, what should the environment look like. And as you can see here, for example, he's being overtaken pretty soon by another car. This is very important because it's quite a unique road that we are going to have here in Stockholm with this, the size of it and the number of traffic that is here. And it's actually quite interesting to drive through. And the main impact of it is that it's a very long tunnel, and you need significant information to have a good drive through. Well, this is the simulator, what it looks like. And it's quite unique. It's not very often done for infrastructure projects, this kind of investigation between the human factor and the technology that you have within the tunnel. The environmental discussions have been going on through the project, and it's a very vital issue, and there are several aspects on it. The main aspect that has been is the conflicts on the surface. I mean, you have like Loven, the central part of it, is a World Heritage Area with Drottningholm, which is a conflict on the surface. You also have the energy and the climate. What will the impact be of Förbifarten compared to if you do not have Förbifarten? Well, as I said before in the beginning, Stockholm area needs both. We need both infrastructure for the public transport and we need infrastructure for the road. And with or without Förbifarten, that's not the key issue if you are going to reach the goals that the government has set up for environmental sustainable society. The difference in CO2 is approximately 1% within the region, with or without the bypass. The traffic increases approximately with 3% with or without the bypass. Well, I think I mentioned this before, it's within the climate, within the tunnel. And the main problem here is that we are using, during the winter, we are using tires with studs, which makes small particles within the tunnel area. And that needs good ventilation and several other means of for example, lowering speed when we have the highest amount of studs during the winter. And within these questions we are doing more research within the project as well. I didn't mention the building process is also a very important part of environmental issues, and we are doing a lot of research and investigation in how to reduce the environmental impact by using proper materials and using energy efficient transportation and so on. So that's a very important part also within the actual building process. And that was the last picture. I think I addressed these three questions, and I hope they are answered. So, thank you very much.
Lecture.
I wonder if it in the future the petrol gets more and more expensive and we might drive car less. As I understood it, this tunnel is not suitable for trains, so you could not rebuild it into rail afterwards. Is that correct?
Well, it's probably not suitable for public transport with rail, but it is suitable for public transport with bus, and you can have electrical buses, for example. We have looked into the matter of having electrical driven buses within the tunnel, and there is space enough within the tunnel to have electrical buses.
I'm wondering how it works. Do you filter the air before it reaches the outdoor environment?
Sorry, where are you sitting?
Here.
There. No, the main, the solution today doesn't mean that you filter the air before you let it out. And the reason is that there are no technical equipment that are sufficient to do that today. And the impact on the environment is very, very small. It's hardly noticeable within the region or within the area where it comes out. But we are looking into, we are following the technical development to see if it's possible during these 10 years it's going to be constructed.
Yeah, because industries use it very well. I mean, why not?
Pardon?
Industries use it very well. Why not use it within this area as well, if you can?
Yeah, I didn't catch the last thing, but we can...
That is used a lot of filtering industries, and the question was if we...
Yeah, but it's not... Well, that's true, and it's not the same situation when you use it within industries, because there you have a fixed area. Here you have a movement within, it's an airflow within an area where traffic goes through, and it's very hard to have filters that are reasonably good and that are economically sustainable as well. It's been tried in several projects, but it doesn't work.
Okay, the movie you just showed in the beginning, it stated that the tunnel has limited impact on the environment, and my question would now be, if that really is what you, or what the planners believe, because as you also said, the building process will have a huge impact on the environment. And also, I don't really think that it's proven until now what impact such a big tunnel and the warmth it produces will have on the environment. It's not like in Switzerland where the tunnel is going 200 or 300 meters below a mountain. It's more to the, what they called, the overground, the surface. Thanks. It's nearer to the surface, and it will have some impact, especially in the winter time. At least I think so. My question would now be, if there is any knowledge, if such a tunnel will have an impact on the environment.
Well, you mean, for example, according to groundwater leakage or some like that? I mean, we have looked into one of the environmental aspects here, as I mentioned, is that we look into the effects and aspects of groundwater. What happens when you dig a tunnel? Of course, the groundwater will leak into the tunnel, and we make sure that it's tight enough, it's secure enough, and that the water doesn't leak in more than necessary. And that is one aspect of a tunnel, of course. Okay. So far, I mean, it's like the tunnels that we have here in Stockholm already. We haven't seen, to my knowledge, any of those aspects on these tunnels. No, not the kind that you say, no.
Okay, maybe we have a question over here, and then we have to round off, I think, for next speaker.
No, my question is not technical, but more about, like, if you would suppose that the traffic condition wouldn't increase on Essingeleden compared to how it is today, could it have been a solution to just lower the speed limit if the major problem is that there are small accidents that that just cause some big problems? Because
you mean, sorry if I catch your question, but you meant that if you...
Did you consider very easy solutions, like maybe just regulations of speed limits on Essingeleden to prevent those little accidents to happen? That maybe is the biggest reason today for...
Yeah, but it's one problem is, of course, minor incidents or major accidents on Essingeleden, and it's part of it is due to the speed. But there is also a major problem that there is too little capacity. I mean, it's yeah, but it has been. I mean, there has been a lot of different measures being done during the years. I mean, from the beginning, Essingeleden had 3 lanes. Today, it has 4 lanes. A lot of traffic solutions has been made to make the traffic go smoother. And I think it's like these 1-4 measures that was talked about before. And many of these has been done, but it isn't sufficient.